HaMakuya, the rural environment of 20 villages rooted in the Limpopo province of South Africa, the place of Chief Makuya. The villages are home to the strong-willed, resilient, and heartwarming Venda people. Bringing with us many of the developed world environmental assumptions associated with our North Carolina State University education, the Imagine Study Abroad team was gifted with a new kaleidoscopic perspective. Scene: traditional round thatch-roofed mud huts interspersed with modernized rectangular brick houses. Heard: daunting drip, drip, dripping of precious water leaving the village tap, the sloshing of the impure liquid secured inside a jerry can. Smelled: sweet, fresh air untarnished by urban pollution, and the chalky baobab fruit peeled back by calloused hands. Tasted: warm, sticky, delicious pop kneaded and stewed by the muscles of the Venda mothers. Felt: submersion into soulful culture, clothed in traditional Minwenda skirts, dancing to the drumming and chanting of village women and children. The 2016 Imagine team studied abroad for an eye-opening 3 weeks, immersed in the culture and environment of South Africa. We applied social ecological research methods and hands-on field testing to analyze the interconnections within South African society between the economy and the environment. In exploring these complex connections, we became aware of a formidable imbalance around water sustainability, which has energized our felt responsibility to spread the awareness. While in HaMakuya, we tested a variety of water sources and quality parameters, interviewed the Venda locals on their usage and perception of water, and appreciated genuine communication within the rural communities. Our experience put faces behind glaring statistics and sparked new revelations and convictions concerning water conservation and sustainability. To more critically comprehend the sustainability balancing act of present day, we first pivoted back into the past to grasp the history of South Africa. As with most complex issues, the water crisis is a product of a tangled web of variables, including poor infrastructure, inequitable distribution, insufficient communication among stakeholders, and persisting severe drought. First, to understand the water crisis, we examine existing poor infrastructure built back in the apartheid era. From the moment of its official dawning in 1948, apartheid produced radical forms of environmental injustice, including discriminate water distribution systems. Rural Africans became subject to the poor resources and inefficiency of the so-called homeland governments. This disconnect dominoed into unorganized chaos throughout the overall system and made failures difficult to identify. The inadequate infrastructure that resulted from poor planning induced a struggle for local people within South Africa townships and rural villages to access reliable water sources.
Historically, with the apartheid government, there was, Eddie pointed it out already, that there was very unequal distribution of water to people. And even now, you know, somebody like me has certainly, the impact of drought doesn't affect somebody like me as much as it would somebody living in a local village.
In addition to poor infrastructure, dismantled government provoked inequitable water distribution. When the apartheid was abolished, the newly democratic South African government recognized that water was being inequitably distributed throughout the country. In 1998, 4 years after the apartheid ended, the National Water Act was established. The purpose of this act was to reform laws regarding water resources and to repeal those that would be detrimental to the balance of water allocation. The Water Act focused on human water rights as well as gave the environment itself priority for available water. South Africa's Water Act states, The guiding principles recognize the basic human needs of present and future generations, the need to protect water resources. The recognition that water is a basic human right, a right that is also owed to the environment, is the first step towards mitigating the water crisis. Yet, the Imagine team discovered that many individual villages must purchase additional diesel fuel in order to operate local boreholes. The fuel is not distributed sufficiently, and is a direct result to many local water shortages, simply because some villages are not provided enough diesel to retrieve water from the ground below. Every stakeholder must work together to balance fuel distribution and thus strengthen water sustainability within HaMakuya. The fact remains that communication is also a key variable in working towards a more equitable form of water sustainability. Poor water distribution may be exacerbated by insufficient communication. The next step will demand the government's responsibility to shape a transparent communication system that includes HaMakuya locals who struggle to gain the basic right to enough clean water. The system will ultimately require viability for communication between all stakeholders, including government institutions and local communities. South Africa's National Water Act of 1998 denotes a representative of every village that is responsible to relay individuals' comments and concerns on local water issues. Through a representative relationship, the National Water Act provides a portal for local community stakeholders to be a part of the decision-making process on how water should be allocated. Currently, the responsibility for organizing the communication structure is shifting and is not yet transparent. In order to improve water distribution in South Africa, a responsibility and a voice needs to be clearly implemented for each stakeholder, for every human being. Alongside variables of infrastructure, distribution, and communication, water resource quantity also plays an essential role in the Sustainability Balancing Act. The climate and landscape of South Africa is changing rapidly. Rivers and other bodies of water are drying out, exposing the sandy and rocky terrain beneath. Surface and groundwater resources rely heavily on rainfall for renewal. We see elephants strategizing their survival by digging deep into dry riverbeds for limited moisture. We see humans storing water for drinking and sanitation, which leaves little to spare for crops and livestock. Water renewal is desperately needed, yet, due to our changing climate, rainfall is becoming significantly more scarce.
I'm going to speak with a kind of a domestic, South African domestic perspective here, because the present drought in South Africa has given a very strong indication of the role climate change has on water use and availability. And the way I've seen it play out here is the adaptation to water management has only been affected or absorbed by certain sectors in the economy. And I don't see that as having a larger benefit. What I mean by that is there's certain sectors, i.e. commercial agriculture and so forth, that have had to bring in very large restrictions on their use, with certain knock-ons on the local economy, the regional economy, as well as food security. We have to recognize that South Africa is increasingly moving into a food insecure status. We're starting to import our staples. And we need to look critically when we're managing our water. Does it make sense to necessarily restrict the water that provides for food security, but no restrictions on other uses?
The lack of available water generates a sense of hopelessness among the people in these villages. Most are forced to wait idly for designated days in which the water pumps will be turned on. And even then, water is not guaranteed. Drought and many other environmental consequences due to human-induced climate change are growing exponentially. During a homestay in one of the HaMakuya villages, Maladzuela, local woman Rendani spoke out about her idea of climate change.
When you talk about climate change, it's not in our power. It's all about nature. The country, the climate change, you can't expect everything. The only thing you can do is cry and pray that the climate change won't affect people's lives.
And that's when we heard it. The sound of the water crisis echoing. The first two water taps we visited that day trickled with water from the surrounding village's boreholes. We approached the third tap with high hopes and expectations. Members of our team approached the pump with an empty pitcher to obtain a water sample. We were taken aback when the only thing produced was an awful hissing noise. The pipes screamed in an effort to tap into the non-responsive water source below. The sound of dry resonates. It is the sound of poor infrastructure, inequitable distribution, insufficient communication, drought. The sound of drought is one in many dominoed effects, and it's only growing in severity. Through conducting transdisciplinary research, the Imagine team developed an understanding of how the HaMakuya community struggled to improve the standard of living while maintaining ecosystem health. The data collected in 2016 contributes to Imagine's pre-existing 5-year research base, which includes both hard and soft scientific components. Imagine recognizes that the data pool is limited. However, it does provide insight to potential factors surrounding the water crisis in HaMakuya. Let's take a closer look into the research conducted in 2016. The Imagine team measured water quality and availability within the Maladzuela, Sonari, and Mukamawabani villages. The two parameters we will discuss regarding water quality are salinity and the presence of E. coli. The average salinity of the water sources we measured was 455 parts per million. This is significantly higher than the average freshwater salinity, which is less than 10 parts per million. These abnormally high measurements cause the water to have a noticeably salty taste. Although these levels do not cause health problems, they do affect the overall perception of the water. Our surveys revealed that many villagers felt their water was unsavory or sour. Salty water also made it difficult for people to feel fully clean after bathing and left their hair and skin dry.
The water is hard to drink because it is salty. After a few days of sitting there, the water is no longer clean. I would just drink it because there are no other options. I would want the water not to be salty. Even when we are bathing, we find we're not clean enough because the water is too salty.
The presence of E. coli is a major indicator of poor water quality and causes health problems for those who consume it. Animal and human feces are the main inducers of E. coli, which was found present in many rivers and hand pumps throughout the villages. Possible causes are leaching from pit latrines and runoff from livestock. The mechanics of hand pumps limit the depth of the water source it can pull from to a maximum of roughly 34 feet. Compared to standard wells that average depths between 100 and 200 feet, these hand pumps are close to the ground surface, which makes them more susceptible to leaching from pit latrines. In addition, rivers have no filtration mechanism to prevent livestock feces from running off and contaminating the underground water table. Not only was water quality an issue, but the majority of the subjects we surveyed stated that they wanted more water. When comparing the amount of water villages had access to 15 years ago to the amount of water they currently have, over 51% believe they have less now than before. Additionally, while conducting water quality tests of taps around the villages, we discovered that a lot of them were dry. A single tap is the source of water for a large number of households. One being dry means that numerous families have to take risks to travel farther in order to attain water. These are some of the harsh water realities the people of HaMakuya face. Their standard of living is drastically different than what we, from the United States, have grown accustomed to. There is great disparity between the lifestyle of the people in HaMakuya and Americans.
When I think about water, certainly in South Africa, it's probably a big, almost a symbol of inequality. So there's lots of things that can be seen as being unequal in this country, but water, certainly water provision is not something that's available equally to everybody.
According to the United States Geological Survey, the average American uses between 300 and 380 liters of water per day. The collective research conducted in HaMakuya regarding water usage revealed that an average of only 13.5 liters per person per day is used by the people inhabiting these villages. That's only about 3% of American per capita water usage. Although these statistics don't represent the current water crisis wholly, the disparity between them induces both frustration and gratitude, while raising concerns about our water consumption practices and overall lifestyles as Americans. 50 liters of water per person per day is needed to ensure all personal hygiene, food hygiene, domestic cleaning, and laundry needs. This village falls well below this standard. It is important that we have an awareness that the ease of access that we experience in America daily, and often take for granted, is highly valuable in developing countries like South Africa. The complexity of this problem demands an equally complicated solution. Because of its multifaceted nature, the notion that one field of study can produce a feasible solution is unrealistic. Solving problems around water distribution will require a transdisciplinary approach, a blend of solutions from diverse groups of people contributing unique perspectives. Every individual utilizes the benefits of what the environment engineers, so it is our collective responsibility to take care of it. In doing so, we are taking care of the people on the other side of the world, or in our own backyard, who are feeling the effects of the abuse we have inflicted on the earth. Once we, as a global community, understand the realities of lives unseen and listen to voices of one another and of nature, we will take the ultimate steps toward sustainable water distribution and healthy quality, toward collectively appreciating Earth's generous luxury. We are extremely fortunate to have experienced South Africa firsthand, and we feel responsible to spread the awareness of HaMakuya's reality. Our overall perspective has transformed, and we choose to change our behavior for a better tomorrow. We aren't just citizens of America, but citizens of a much larger global community. There are people on the opposite side of the world that are feeling the consequences of our actions. These people aren't just statistics, but have faces, names, and families. We have the opportunity to do our part to take care of the Earth and all of its inhabitants so that it can continue to take care of us and future generations.